Welcome to a new episode of The Picture Show. Today we'll be diving into Guillermo del Toro's latest monster movie masterpiece, The Shape of Water. Let's take a look.
If I told you about her, the princess without voice, what would I say?
She deaf?
Mute, sir. She can hear you.
You clean that lab, you get out.
This may very well be the most sensitive asset ever to be housed in this facility.
You may think that thing looks human. Stands on two legs, right? But we're created in the Lord's image. You don't think that's what the Lord looks like, do you?
This creature is intelligent. Capable of language, of understanding emotions.
When he looks at me, he does not know how I am incomplete. He sees me as I am.
J'avoue, je n'ai bavé pas vous. Mon amour, avant d'avoir eu vent de vous.
The natives in the Amazon worshipped him. Mother God.
Get him out. What are you talking about? No.
We need to take it apart, learn how it works.
I don't want an intricate, beautiful thing destroyed.
We can do nothing. I'm sorry.
Don't do this, Eliza.
What is she saying?
Don't do this.
Oh, God, it's not even human.
If I told you about her, what would I say? I wonder.
That was our first look at Shape of Water. This was directed by Guillermo del Toro, coming out December 1st last year. It had a budget of $19.5 million and has already grossed over $41.2 million worldwide. With a runtime of two hours and 3 minutes, we had a good understanding of what it meant to be a fish in love. I am your guest. I'm your host, Alex Richardson. This is our special guest, Cody Lewis. I said guest because originally, I was your guest on the show.
Yeah, what was it, maybe two or three years ago?
About 2 or 3 years ago, yeah. Like, the seats have turned. Tables have turned. Today, we're talking about The Shape of Water. Mm-hmm. Cody, give us your official synopsis of the film.
So, The Shape of Water is about this young mute girl. She's not deaf. She hears everything, but she's not able to speak. And she works as a janitor for a government facility. And while there, they get a new item that they call the asset throughout the film that catches her eye, and she's just drawn to him. And it's this big old fish man who draws a lot from Abe Sapien, as well as the classic Creature from the Black Lagoon.
Well, we got that our little Abe Sapien comic here on our display table.
And she's slowly falling in love with the asset. And we see that he may be falling for her a little bit because he calms down a lot with her. And it's just a story of their adventure.
It's basically a look into whether or not this animalistic beast can feel love for a human person. Referred to as a god a lot in the film by our lead, would you say, our lead antagonist?
Yeah, the security guard, what's his name?
His name is Michael Shannon, the actor. He plays a character called Richard Strickland.
Yeah.
And I'll also give Sally Hawkins plays Eliza Esposito, who is our main lead. And then Doug Jones plays the amphibian, also called the asset, who also played Ape Sapien.
Yeah, he plays Ape Sapien. He plays in all of Guillermo's movies.
Because he was the Pale?
Yeah, he's the Pale Man as well as the Fawn in Pan's Labyrinth.
Yeah.
And then he played Ape Sapien, of course, as well as multiple characters throughout Hellboy. So, like, the moment when we see the Angel of Death in Hellboy 2, that's him as well. It's just because he has this weird body shape and, like, a long neck that... often he's chosen to...
I think Guillermo del Toro referred to him as just like a beautiful actor for the films that he mm-hmm. directs.
And in a lot of behind the scenes, he talks about how he chooses him because in these suits, you want an actor. You don't want just someone who can get in there and then like dub over it later and all that. You want someone who's going to act in this. And I think that's a... Because he uses a lot of practical effects
in
this film.
It's not a big CGI fest.
Yeah.
And this film itself has been nominated for 13 Oscars. Mm-hmm. And I have down here, because there are so many of them, the ones that I think appeal to me the most, they have Best Picture, Best Actress, Best Director, Best Costume Design, and Best Production Design. Mm-hmm. Those are the ones that appeal to me the most. Do you think this film is a shoe-in for any of them?
For their set, that I definitely see... as well as for costume.
Because this was filmed within the year, basically, like, within the 1960s.
Yeah.
And it oozes that aesthetic.
Yeah. So they throw it to a lot of the, you know, the classic 60s, especially with the antagonist's family and all that. But then back at the facility, it gives you that very... steam.
It's very green and dark in there, and it just basically gives you ideas like, it's like, this, yeah, it's a government facility. It's like, it's not a lot of good things happening in here, probably. Mm-hmm. But that being said, with the nominations, you said that it has some other news right now.
Yeah, with a lot of the Oscar buzz going on with it right now, there is suddenly some other news that came out referring to a Paul Zindel play that came out in the 60s, early 70s. Called, what was the name of it? The Let Me Hear You Whisper. The movie is about a young mute woman who is a janitor at a facility where she falls in love with a dolphin that's being kept there prisoner. And in the film, I mean, in the play, they actually have, like, she has a dance number she does for the fish, for the dolphin, and they work on trying to get him out after they find out he may get killed.
All right.
So, as you see, there's a lot of things that are similar.
Yeah, there's some similarities, but with what we've both learned about Guillermo del Toro within the making of this movie, Guillermo del Toro, since he was a child, has loved this mm-hmm. sense of this character. This was a love letter to Creature of the Black Lagoon.
Yeah, because he was initially pegged to direct the film for Universal. But
for their failed Dark Universe.
Yeah,
story,
but because of he wanted to make an alternate, like a different ending where
because,
the fish falls.
Yeah,
because
like the whole idea was that the creature from Black Lagoon doesn't get the girl, of course, because he's the gross, grotesque monster mm-hmm. that got sent back in the lake, the lagoon. But Gamma as a child was like, well, why can't they end up together? What's keeping them from each other? And so. Like, it was actually read that he created a bunch of fan fiction, basically, as a kid. Like, his mm-hmm. own drawings, his own stories, where they do, like, they get married and they go on dates. And so he's always, I think, had this film in the back of his mind. And, like, maybe he took some ideas from Let Me Hear You Whisper, but I think, I fully think this is an original film from him.
Yeah.
So I think it's just, you know, people... want to be like, I was like, hey,
yeah,
that's kind
it was not
there's no
for
such thing
Oscar,
as new ideas
so,
anymore, really.
Because there was a short film that came out in 2015 that drew a lot from Let Me Hear You Whisper, and that they never went to court over,
yeah.
But for this, there's
I think it's because
there's
it's getting
talk,
Oscar
but, yeah.
buzz and everything like that. I would think more people would have some kind of fault with the similarities to Ape Sapien. He looks fairly similar, and as you pointed, because we saw this together, as
yeah.
you pointed in the movie, he shares a similar power to
yeah.
Ape Sapien. He has a superpower, basically.
Mm-hmm.
And I'll let you explain basically what it does.
So, yeah, Ape Sapien, he can heal himself fairly quickly, as well as in the movie, we kind of see that he's able to, that the asset is able to heal others. Now,
because,
Ape,
Giles, played by Richard Jenkins, is a bald man. Mm-hmm. And, like, so the acid kind of, like, pats his head a little bit, and then, like, later he wakes up the next day and he has a little tuft of hair growing out of his head. And I think, and then, like, his skin starts glowing blue and stuff like that. And I remember you and Theo's like, that's Abe Sapien's power.
Yeah. So, yeah, Abe Sapien, there's a lot of similarities between the two. And Abe Sapien, of course, is when he was found, he was considered a god by the indigenous villages around him. And he has an affinity for boiled eggs that we see a lot in the Hellboy movies. But in this movie, there's a moment where they see some artwork. Even in the trailer, you get to see some artwork that they draw, and it just looks like Abe Sapien from the comic books.
Yeah, you could think that he probably was just like, let's just get these character sketches that possibly even the artist did or something like that and use them for a film.
Yeah.
But we're going to cut to a commercial break and come back. We'll continue talking about the film. Stay tuned, though, because when we get back, we will be talking about what's new to Netflix and DVD. See you then.
If you're part of an average American family, you may eat as many as 1 in 5 meals outside the home. When eating out, children like to choose their dinners from the kids' menu. But should parents let them? That was the topic of a recent study by the Center for Science in the Public Interest. The study found that many kids' menu options met the government's daily recommendation for children, 1,500 calories and 17 grams of saturated fat, in just one meal. While adult menus have gotten healthier, most kids' menus continue to mimic fast food choices, but with bigger servings. More healthful options than the ever-present burgers and fries might be pasta with tomato sauce and a side salad, grilled chicken, or grilled fish. Parents may want to consider the number of healthy choices on the kids' menu before choosing a restaurant. The number of overweight and obese young people has nearly doubled in the past 2 decades.
Hey there, welcome to this week's Netflix and DVD Picks of the Week. My name's Cody Vaughn, so let's just get right into it. Available on Netflix this week, we have Aeon Flux, starring Charlize Theron and Frances McDormand. This comic book adaptation follows Aeon Flux, an assassin with a mysterious past, working with a group of rebels to overthrow the government in the distant future. Now, when she is sent on a mission to kill the chairman of the New World, she uncovers a mystery about herself that will change everything. Next up, we have Goodfellas, starring Ray Liotta, Joe Pesci, and Robert De Niro. Now, this story is of Henry Hill and his life in the mob during the heyday of the Italian-American crime syndicate. And then after that, we have Cabin Fever, starring Jordan Ladd and Ryder Strong. A group of college grads rent a cabin in the woods and fall victim to a horrifying flesh-eating virus, which attracts the unwanted attention of the homicidal locals around. Next up, we have Suburbicon, starring Matt Damon and Julianne Moore. As a 1950s community self-destructs, a home invasion has sinister consequences for this seemingly normal family. After that, we have All I See Is You, starring Blake Lively and Jason Clarke. In this movie, a blind woman's relationship with her husband is drastically changed when she has a procedure done to regain her vision. And last but not least, we have Battle Creek, starring Pennywise himself, Bill Skarsgård, but not as a clown, but as a young man with a rare skin disease who has kept sheltered his whole life under the close watch of his mother. But one night, a young woman's car breaks down and changes Henry's life forever. Well, that was this week's Netflix and DVD Picks of the Week. I hope you enjoy whatever movie from here you choose to watch. My name's Cody Vaughn. Let's get back to the picture show.
Welcome back as we continue our discussions with The Shape of Water. Cody, we were talking about the film and like a lot about the director with Guillermo del Toro, and I know you have an affinity for directors. You really like directors, specifically one director that I know of, Kevin Smith. Mm-hmm. Kevin Smith was quoted of this film, and I just wanted to see what you thought about this quote of his.
Yeah.
And I have it written down because I'm not going to try to paraphrase this. Kevin Smith is quoted as saying, "Seeing something as beautiful as this makes me feel stupid for ever calling myself a director." What would you like? What do you think about that?
I can very much so understand that. I know with like any kind of music, sometimes when you see someone who's just so good that you're like, I don't even know why I tried. but yeah, this movie is a very beautiful film.
It was, I think, a very aesthetically pleasing film. Mm-hmm. I think anytime I tell somebody like, you need to go watch this film, it's like even if you don't want to watch a fish possibly fornicate with a human female. You want to watch just how this movie looks.
Yeah. In the trailer, they kind of tease the asset a lot.
Mm-hmm.
But the movie is very much like he's just standing there.
Yeah.
All real, like, tall and stoic. And I know for the film, to kind of pull away from Abe Sapien a lot, he actually changed the designs. Because Abe Sapien...
It's very sleek. And
yeah, when they were designing it, they were designing it after a dolphin. Yeah. This one, he's
much more fish.
Yeah, Guillermo talked about his drawings and designs, because he'll actually sketch everything out himself, that he designed it after koi fish, though he didn't take the colors. He wanted...
Yeah, like medieval, I think I remember reading that, medieval depictions, or like old depictions of koi fish, like from old art and stuff like mm-hmm. that. Very almost dragon-like, because there was the idea of like the koi fish making at the waterfall turns into a dragon, and that's how they were depicted a lot. And like you can kind of see, because he has like the fins and the barbs everywhere, and like that heavy scales and the gills. And, like he looked like a beast, a monster,
yeah.
But like also very human. And I will say, like I did say it earlier, the possible fornication with the female. This is a rated R movie.
Yes.
About a fish man and a human woman, and there is some interaction between the two. I think we can safely say.
Yeah.
One of my favorite parts in the film actually is when the supporting actress Octavia Spencer, who plays her best friend Zelda Fuller, like she's helping her throughout the film, kind of like sometimes unwittingly, but when she finds out what's really happening, and like she's like. We're gonna get in so much trouble for this girl, and like helps her get the fishman, because they're in the film they do rescue the asset from the facility, and it's like she's kind of hiding him in her apartment. Eliza is, but there's this really iconic scene that's probably gonna be one of my favorite scenes from the film, where Eliza, as they're keeping him in the bathroom, because it's where the water is.
Yeah.
And so she closes the bathroom door and just kind of starts turning on like the sink faucets and the bathtub and everything. And unrealistically, the room starts to fill with water and everything. And they start kind of like swaying around in the water. And as it completely fills, they're almost like dancing, but they're about to get freaky
mm-hmm.
in the water. And so as they're going, like they do all that, it's like the next day where she's like, pushing her little cleaning car. She's so I was like, why are you so happy? And she goes, I can't say anything. She's like, did you with him? How even? And it's just like, it's such a natural friendship between the two. And I was like, I remember in this film, I'm like, yeah, you get that fish, man.
Yeah. For me, my favorite scene in the film is where they kind of pull away from everything that's going on. And it's when they're sitting at the dinner table, and it kind of goes into a big, like, singing dance number.
Oh, yeah.
And I love it because it cuts, like, black and white, so it's, like, all the shows and stuff that she's watching, and she's singing.
It's Sally Hawkins who, like, as we both said, like, plays a mute woman, mm-hmm. and, like, who doesn't talk for the whole film except this dream sequence of hers. And she is a beautiful singer.
Yeah.
And so the whole time, I was like, what's happening? But then I'm like, I'm just enjoying
and
this.
And what's great about this scene is that, like, everything is all big and beautiful, and she's got this nice dress and all this. And it's like it's like back then, exactly how these would look. And then you got the asset, who's not in anything.
He's still
just
a giant
big old
fish man. But like he's an excellent dancer, Doug Jones. What was it? Do you know if that was Doug Jones still in the car?
It should have been.
He's a great dancer.
Mm-hmm.
Like he was doing really well, especially for being in such a huge suit.
Yeah.
another really favorite part of good part of the film for me was Sally's friend Giles, who plays an artist. He's an artist in these 1960s. He's an advertisement artist, and he hand paints all these advertisers. There's a running joke about Jell-O in the film, because like he paints like this red Jell-O, and he takes it to his friend, and he's like, "Well, they like it green now." And there's another part in the film where Rip Strickland's wife just like, "I just got some green Jell-O," and all stuff like that. But besides the point, he plays a gay man that's never explicitly said, he's just like he. Like, you kind of start like getting the sense because like he has this really awkward encounter with one of his old friends, and he goes to this diner that he really likes because the guy who works the counter is really nice, talks to him a lot, and they they actually start talking some more. He sits down. He's like, you're a really smart guy. He's like, you know, you're a really smart fellow. I really like when you come in here. He's like, maybe we can, you know, get to know each other some more. And kind of puts his hand over, and the guy's just like, whoa, what are you doing there, fella? And immediately after that, this black couple walks in and goes like, hey, the seats are reserved. He's like, we just want to sit down. He's like, no, all the seats are reserved. You need to go get out of here. And then immediately realizes that this guy that he's kind of really liked is just this homophobic, racist guy in the 1960s. And I thought that was a pretty cool film because it shows that while we're sitting there saying how this fish man is, it's like, oh, he's not human. He's not like the rest of us. There's still this sense of racism. It's like, well, like that's not even just for the fish man.
Yeah.
This is for anybody of any other color or creed. I thought that was a pretty good, like, it wasn't overt in the film, but I thought it was a good subtext.
Yeah, and the head of security, you kind of see him do that because he treats Eliza and Zelda differently because they're women, and then Zelda because she's
black, and then Eliza because she's mute.
Yeah, and so he's constantly like almost attacking them, but like just kind of messing with them.
So with that being said, what would you rate this film?
Out of how many stars?
We'll do 5.
Out of 5 stars, I really enjoyed this movie. I'm gonna get it on Blu-ray when it comes out, so I'd probably give it a 4 out of 5.
4 out of 5?
Yeah.
We'll take that 1 star away.
I'm not constantly wanting to go back and watch this movie over and over and over again.
Yeah.
It's a very beautiful film. For me, 5 stars has to be, I love everything about this movie and I'm constantly watching it.
All right. Well, that was our look over at, The Shape of Water, and stay tuned as we talk about our Friday flick pick, what to see this Friday, coming up.
Some tips that can be the right prescription for taking medicine safely and helping the medicine have its desired effect. Start by asking your doctor, pharmacist, or other healthcare professional about the right way to take any medicine before you begin to use it. Always find out if it should be taken as needed or on a schedule and whether or not it should be taken at a particular time of day. You should also find out if you need to take the medicine with food and whether or not you can drink alcohol while taking it. Don't forget to ask the doctor how long you will have to take the medicine and how you will feel once you start taking it. You should also find out what to do in the event you forget to take the medication. Sometimes, even medication that is meant to be beneficial can have side effects. Find out if that is the case with anything you're taking and what the effects might be. And make sure your doctor knows about any medications and supplements you're taking on a regular basis, since they may make the medicine less effective.
Thanks for tuning in to the Friday Flick Picks of the Week. I'm Sarah Patterson. Coming this Friday is Winchester, starring Helen Mirren, Sarah Snook, and Jason Clark. Inspired by true events, on an isolated stretch of land 50 miles outside of San Francisco sits the most haunted house in the world, built by Sarah Winchester, heiress to the Winchester fortune. It is a house that knows no ends, but Sarah did not build it for herself, for her niece, or the troubled Dr. Eric Price, whom she has summoned to the house. She is building a prison, an asylum for hundreds of vengeful ghosts, and the most terrifying among them have a score to settle with the Winchesters. Let's take a look at the trailer.
This gargantuan 7-storied structure was built on the orders of a grieving widow, Sarah Winchester. We're worried about her sanity. It's a gargantuan 7-storied structure with no apparent rhyme or reason. Each maze of halls more confusing than the next. It's under never-ending construction. It was built on the orders of a grieving widow. Sarah Winchester is the majority shareholder of the Winchester Repeating Arms Company. You want to take it away from her. We're worried about her sanity, Dr. Price.
Do you believe in ghosts, Doctor?
I do not believe in anything I cannot see or study.
can feel it. In the air, in the walls.
This spirit has a power we've not seen before.
It has found us.
Well, that was our Friday Flick Pick of the Week. I'm Sarah Patterson, off to the movies. Now, back to Picture Show.
And that was your Friday Flick Pick with Sarah Patterson. Cody, it was great to have you on the set today. Been a while since you've been on this set, for sure.
Yeah.
I think it's I like the fact that my first time being on here was as your guest, and now you're my guest.
Yeah.
Well, tune in next week with the Picture Show, where we'll be talking about a movie that would make you want to run off and join the circus. That's all I'm going to say for it. So, like I said, watch. We'll see you then next week.